Okay, hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Blown Speakers. This is episode 28. I'm Dave Hoenigman, coming from Yokohama, Japan, and this is our very special guest, Kay.
Hi. Hey, yes. Guys.
Thanks for joining us. Right.
Thanks for having me here.
And yeah, I'm very impressed that you agreed to do this because so you're our first guest who is not a native English speaker, right? I'm impressed by your bravery. So thank you. And so where are you from? Can you please tell our viewers?
Yeah, I come from China, and my hometown is just a small city named Xining. It's located in the northwest of China. So, and I'm a master student in Japan now. I came here like only 3 months ago.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So you've only been in Japan for 3 months, and unfortunately, during the pandemic time.
Yeah. Yeah, we cannot go outside, kind of frustrated.
But let's hope in the near future, maybe later this year, we can go places and do things, I hope.
Hope that can be. Hope everything will be fine in the near future.
Okay. So today, right, we're going to talk about PJ Harvey's 1993 album, Rid of Me. Okay. And this was Kay's idea, right? You wanted to talk about this album. And, I was very delighted that you chose this album because I love this album. It's one of my favorite albums. So thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. So, can I ask why did you choose Rid of Me?
Well, actually, I think this album made PJ Harvey famous. And I'm a big fan of PJ Harvey from 9 years ago. And I think this album is, it's her second album, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I am in the same age when she made this album.
Okay.
So it kind of have a special meaning for me right now. And I chose this album. Besides, I really love the cover of this album. I have this same poster in my room. Oh. So I chose this album.
Yeah, it's a very, very iconic album cover, right?
Yeah, it's like she looks like dangerous, right?
She does. And I always thought like she's kind of trying to look like a man in this photo. Do you think? Like kind of this shadow kind of looks like body hair to me. So I thought, what?
It looks like body hair. And the background is like some dark basement.
Mm-hmm.
Her hairstyle is like, yeah. And I think her eyebrow is like the man type, right?
Yeah.
So she looks like a man, really dangerous type, the really dangerous type.
Yeah, yeah. So it's kind of like a reverse David Bowie or something, right? So it's a girl who's trying to look like kind of a tough guy, I think. But but it's still you could see it's a girl, right? So it's really the photo's very captivating, I think. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that's interesting. You thought the background looks like kind of a dangerous, like basement or something, like a very dangerous place.
Dark basement.
Yeah.
And going to be crazy and like helpless, but it's going to crazy, kind of that feeling. There's some dark basement.
Yes, yeah. So yeah. We're seeing some like very scary, bizarre scene, right?
Yeah.
So as, yeah.
Yeah,
as,
it's and she was 23 at that time, and I am 23 now, and you know, now my situation is like going to be crazy. I cannot go outside, you know, it's kind of interesting to review this album right now. Yeah.
Okay, so if you're 23 now, so you discovered it 9 years ago, so you were very young when you heard this.
It's on the first year of my high school, senior high school, when I found this album.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So I want to talk about that later. When you first discovered it. Yeah. I'm especially interested in that, but let me introduce the album for our viewers. Okay. So yes, 1993, her second album. Oops. Oh no. Wait just a moment. Okay. So this is the back cover, right? Kind of a close up of PJ's face, or Polly Jean's face. What do you think of this photo?
I think she looks like Nick Cave, right? I just suddenly thought of Nick Cave. And this one, she looks peaceful. It's totally different from the front cover of this album.
Yeah.
And it's like she became calm after some like I don't know.
After she screamed.
after she screamed
out these songs.
Then she was
calm. Yeah, yeah, that's exactly interesting.
Trying to say.
It's interesting that you mentioned Nick Cave, right? Because they have a connection, right? They became a couple for a while in the mid-90s.
Yeah, and they record a album, I think. I also like that one.
But even here, like her eyes are closed, so I feel like we can't see her real face in a way. At least. So yeah, just to give viewers an idea of her output in the 90s, right? So her debut album was 92, Dry. It was very successful. So Kay, are you a fan of Dry?
Yeah, I'm a fan of Dry, Rid of Me, and To Bring You My Love. When I was in my senior high school, my favorite one would be Dry.
Okay.
Yeah. I think I've mentioned that I have some tattoo from the drawing. I tattoo the lyrics of We Float when I was 17 years old. So I really love that album.
You have a tattoo?
Yeah, I have a tattoo, and it's a lyrics from We Float, the song named We Float.
Okay. Where is it? Your tattoo is what, on your arm? Okay, cool. All right, I want to see it. Just a moment. Let me. Okay.
Okay.
I'm going to make you big screen. Okay, show us. Show us your tattoo.
It's not a good one, but you know, it's the lyrics of the take life as it comes.
Oh, wow.
It should be repeat saying these lyrics in the We Float song.
Sure. Okay.
We Float. Yeah.
You did that yourself?
No, of course.
Oh, okay. You went to a tattoo.
I had someone do this to me when I was 17 years old. So I really love Dry, this album.
Okay. Wow. Yeah, you were 17, you said?
Yeah, when I was 17. I'm still in the senior high school. Okay. So I really love Dry.
Okay, wow. Yeah. Now, did your friends... So I remember when I first talked to you, I asked you, because of course I'm surprised that you're so interested in PJ Harvey, because you're very young, and I think she's kind of an older artist. Yeah. So when you got that tattoo and you showed your friends, how did your friends react? Did they know PJ Harvey or what?
Yeah, they don't know PJ Harvey, and every time my friend asked me about my tattoo, it's like, what's the meaning of that one? And I just say it's something that had a big influence for me, had a big meaning for me. And that's all. I don't want to explain much. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, let's take life as it comes. From WeFloat, and I really love WeFloat, and I love the content of the lyrics.
Okay.
The lyrics, so it's kind of influenced my life attitude. Mm. So that's the reason why I titled it. So I'm the person who always anxiety about the future, about blah blah things. And in PJ Harvey was like, oh, take life as it comes. It's like you worried too much about something in the future. So take life as it comes. So that's the reason why I titled this one or two. Wow. Yeah. Wanted to build a connection to PJ Harvey when I was 17 years old.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Now in Japan, it's very rare for a high school student to get a tattoo. But how about China? Is it?
Yeah, it is rare in China actually. But I'm kind of. It was my teenage time, so I'm kind of the rebel type.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. And I really loved PJ Harvey at that time, so I just did this. But my parents didn't know about this.
Oh, really? They've never seen it? Or
yeah. Oh. Yeah, I only wear long sleeves in the summer. So.
Oh, no. So you can't
secret tattoo related to PJ Harvey. Yeah.
So you can't show your parents this video, right?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, for sure I cannot show. And they cannot understand English, so I won't.
Wow. Okay. I'm impressed. Okay, let's see. So someday we can do another episode about Dry in the future if you like. And to bring you my love, or well, when you and I talked was maybe 4 weeks ago or so, I think. So
yeah.
So you're into a lot of interesting artists. So I hope we will talk about, maybe Sonic Youth in the future and other other bands. Okay, just to give people an idea of PJ Harvey's recorded history during the 90s, right? This was her second album. This is the track listing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So as I said, I'm a big fan of this album. So kind of I love everything about it, right? So I like that all the song titles are very short. And I think it just looks cool as it's presented here, right? like concrete poetry, kind of.
Yeah, and her lyrics always give me that feeling. It's like poetry. I think she writes poetry herself, right?
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. But also, like, something about her lyrics too, that like the lines are, I feel like they're just very sharp. So it's almost like being stabbed with a knife or something. Some of her, like her, the way she, I guess the way she phrases, her lines are always just kind of short and challenging and intense. So I always like that.
Yeah.
At least on this album, right? Because really, like, if you look at her whole career, her sound changes a lot, right? Over the years.
Yeah, it changed a lot. She changed everything a lot. I mean, the outfit, the lyrics, and the topic of her music, she changed a lot.
Okay, so this was recorded by or produced by Steve Albini, who of course was a big shot producer. So before this, he had done the Pixies, Surfa Rosa. He did the Breeders' Pod. He did a few Jesus Lizard albums, Urge Overkill, The Wedding Present. So he was kind of a hot producer. So it was great that because Dry, the first album, was such a success, that they were able to hook up with Steve Albini, and they recorded Rid of Me in, is it Pachyderm? Yeah, Pachyderm Studios in Minnesota. So kind of a very countryside type place, right? Oh, a kind of small private studio in the countryside. And just after, so of course Steve Albini would produce Nirvana's In Utero album. So very, very shortly after this. So after he did Rid of Me, he did an album by Jawbreaker, a kind of punky band, and then he did In Utero. So so it was really a great time in his career, I think, Rid of Me and In Utero, about the same time.
Both albums really great and hot, maybe, and famous at that time, both albums.
And what I like about his production on this album is it does sound very intimate. Like PJ said, she wants it to sound like the band playing in a room, so she wants it to sound very personal. And I think he has the ability to kind of create that closeness, I think. Like, I love the sounds of the percussions and the just drumming throughout the album. And like, even at the beginning of Rub Till It Bleeds, you can hear someone coughing. And you can very clearly hear it. So it sounds very personal. I intimate. I love the atmosphere of the album.
Yeah, me too. The first time I listened Rid of Me, the first image came to me is like they're playing in the basement.
Ah, nice, nice. Exactly. So maybe it's the basement on the album cover, right? and only a three-piece band, right? So you got PJ Harvey is playing guitar, vocals, cello, violin, and organ. Okay, you got Robert Ellis doing drums and percussion, and Steve Vaughn doing bass, right? So just a three-piece band. So it's the same band they used on Dry, right? Same three people, I believe.
Yeah.
December 1992. okay, in Pachyderm Studios, kind of in Minnesota, right? And they recorded, I think, like only 2 weeks. It's very short time they recorded this album. So very cool, right?
Yeah, the whole album is, and the story, the background, everything is cool. Everything was cool.
This picture is on the inside, right? You see, yeah. PJ, and I always get confused which is which. I think this, right, but I do have a picture. Here. Let's see. All right, this is Rob Ellis, right? This is Rob Ellis, mm-hmm. here, and this is Stephen Vaughn. Okay. Mm-hmm. So you have PJ, Rob Ellis, Stephen Vaughn, right? Yeah. But this is like another example for me, like in the early 90s. So before the internet, right, it was very common for me to be very interested in a band or an artist, but not really know what they look like, right? So at this time, I didn't see many pictures of PJ Harvey, only the album cover, right? Which is just kind of a strange photo. So you can't exactly tell what she looks like. Then the picture on the back with her eyes closed, and then this picture, right?
It's blurred. You cannot see her face.
Yeah, yeah. And
so her face is kind of mysterious for you at that time, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's attracting.
yeah, totally. Because it's the same for me with the Pixies. I didn't know what the Pixies looked like for many years, right?
Yeah, too.
And then when I finally saw a picture of them, I was so shocked that they looked like such normal people, right?
Yeah, especially the vocal.
Exactly. Yeah.
I was shocked when I first know what Pixies, the members of Pixies look like. Yeah, I always thought the vocal would be some really skinny and weird person, but exactly. It was totally different.
Yes. Yeah, and especially his name, right? Black Francis. I'm like, oh, like I thought he would look like you know, Trent Reznor or Marilyn Manson, or like that kind of really dark, kind of scary person I was expecting. So when I saw him and he looked kind of completely normal, kind of chubby guy,
yeah,
I was very shocked. And the other like band members, they all just look like nice, safe people. The Pixies. Yes, I was, yeah. So it was, but I remember, even though I loved this album, Rid of Me, but other than that, I didn't know much about PJ Harvey. Like, I don't remember reading any magazine articles about her. So I only knew this album because a friend played it for me, right? And then I bought it. And I knew that she was British, but I didn't know much else about her at all.
Me too, actually. Mm-hmm. I cannot find much information, even on the internet, like 9 years ago. Mm. It's only her name and some, you know, her career story,
uh-huh.
and nothing else. Like, you know, I cannot find much information about her when I was first knowing to her.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Yeah. So that's something I really want to talk about, because our idea about China is that you can't use the internet, right?
Yeah.
I'm sure that's not completely true, but
But that's true. We cannot access to the YouTube, or we cannot even use Google.
Wow.
Right now.
Wow.
Yeah. You have to download or buy some VPN.
Uh-huh.
Then you can use Google or something, you know. So it's really difficult for some music lover, because you cannot listen a lot of music, a lot of foreign music.
Hmm.
China. But now I think it's okay, because some social media, some people on the social media will share many resources, will share many materials about something on the internet. So that's okay.
So it's getting better.
Yeah, it's definitely getting better now.
Mm.
But still, you can, if you want to find something by yourself on YouTube or something, you cannot use it.
Really?
So yeah, I was really lucky. I know PJ Harvey, and I know this album from the one of my friend. He like introduced this album to me, because at that time I'm really crazy about grunge music. And he introduced this album to me, so I was really lucky to, you know, to know musicians like PJ Harvey when I was really young.
Okay. Well, when did you start? Like, what was the first grunge band or 90s band that you were interested in?
Yeah, I think I mentioned this because Nirvana was kind of famous in China. So Nirvana definitely the first grunge band I loved. And then I read the book I mentioned, We Love Our Town.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the grunge history.
Yeah, the oral history of grunge, right?
Yeah. I read that book, and I know a lot of band. I know get to know a lot of grunge band from that book.
Mm.
So that's the way I you know.
But could you hear? So if you don't have access to YouTube, so if you're reading that book and they mention a band like Mudhoney or something, how can you hear the band?
There are some music apps in China,
okay.
And I can use that kind of music app.
Okay.
And some we cannot always, but like Nirvana, Pixies, kind of this successful band, I can hear their works on the music app. But some like Mudhoney, I can listen to their music like 9 years ago.
Okay.
Yeah, but now I can find this band on this kind of music apps.
Okay.
So we can listen to. And some music lover in China, they always create some like a sharing page on the internet, so you can access to the music, some independent bands, if you wanted to listen to their music.
So are your tastes in music kind of typical of your generation in China? So did many of your friends in junior high school and high school, did they listen to Nirvana and
No.
Pixies and stuff?
I don't think so. It's still, yeah, I think rock and some grunge music, especially like grunge music from America or foreign countries is still only have a limited fans in China right now. So I'm not the typical generation, I think. But I think many Chinese young people around my age, they know a lot history about like rock or grunge music, but still it's only not like the mainstream, not like the everyone of my generation would be interested in this kind of music or culture.
But you recommended that one Chinese band to me, right? Carsick Cars.
Yeah.
I listened to their album. Yeah, it's pretty. It's good. Good stuff. Yeah. I was impressed.
Yeah. The Sonic Youth invited them to the tour. So they're kind of really famous around the 90s, even in China. Around 2000s. And three, I think.
Okay.
China, even in China. Actually, in Beijing and Shanghai, there are some great rock music, rock bands around 2005, I think. So, it's like some underground culture in China.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
How about now? Is there good music now?
Yeah. Now it's getting better, actually. Now rock music in China has like it's the golden time of Chinese rock music or independent music. Yeah, there are many new bands and we have shoegaze bands like post-punk, experimental, electronic, everything. So it's kind of like golden age in China. Yeah.
So do you feel like you're missing you're missing out on the opportunity to see bands if you're living in Japan now? Or
yeah, a little bit.
Okay.
Because now I cannot see some live. We cannot go to live house in Japan, but in China they're like every week my friends will go to the band's live, so, and there are some great bands, so. But you know, I'm a really big fan of Japan music, so I'm not it's okay for me.
So you will have opportunities in the near future, right, to see shows in Tokyo, right?
Yeah, that's my purpose for studying here.
Good. Okay, let's see. I didn't exactly know what she looked like for many years, right? Because I don't remember seeing her videos on TV, but I think this time, so 93, I was a university student, so I didn't. I think when I was younger, I watched MTV more. But when I was a university student, I wasn't. So I don't remember seeing her videos. So she has two videos from this album, and I'll show one. But show one now. But I don't think I saw them at this time. So I just like, and I never. Unfortunately, I've never seen PJ Harvey perform live. So I feel sad about that. But but I listened to this album many, many times. And years later, I kind of saw what I could finally see clearly what she looks like, right?
Yeah. I also want to see her live. Performance
life. She came to Japan a few years ago, maybe 2017.
Oh,
But it was kind of just bad timing for me. It was a really busy time, kind of like end of January, end of the semester. I was very busy, so I couldn't go. But I hope someday.
Yeah.
But I think when you look at this picture, it's a similar feeling to what I talked about with the pixies. They just look so normal.
Yeah, they don't look like the band men. Yeah. Some musicians always dress like very in a very weird way. Yeah.
I mean, it's a pretty dark album, right? I mean, dark and glorious and exciting and mind-blowing, but pretty dark. So it's kind of surprising to just see, right? Rob Ellis in a Hawaiian shirt. I would never imagine that. And this is from 93, right? So this is a few months. Oh, you know what I wanted to mention? So if you look at the release date of this album, 1993, but it was May 4th. Right today for us here in Japan, it's May 5th, but actually in America right now, it's still May 4th. So kind of we are talking about this album on its 28th birthday.
Wow.
It's the 28th birthday of the album. So happy birthday to Rid of Me.
Versus, yeah, to Rid of
that's a nice coincidence, huh?
Yeah, I love this kind of coincidence. Wow.
So I love just the gap, yeah, right, between you see Polly when she's kind of in her normal persona, right, kind of her everyday persona. She looks very like a very normal person, and she grew up on some kind of sheep farm, right, in England.
Oh yeah, I know.
Yeah,
it's countryside or rural area.
Yeah, so she's like a total country girl, right?
Yeah.
But right during like this time, or kind of when her music career started to take off, she moved to London, and I heard that she kind of struggled with stage fright initially, right? She was afraid. She was afraid to perform.
Afraid to perform on stage.
Yes. So I think it's why she kind of had to develop kind of this persona, right? So it's like she had to kind of take her identity in a kind of very absurd or direction, right? Before she felt that she could perform at this time. And I think that's kind of interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's because maybe she's an introvert in the normal life, but she looks like totally different, you know, from this picture, like on stage, like a crazy type, but introvert in normal life. Musicians kind of, I think the Kurt Cobain was really shy in the real life, right? But he always like give me the feeling of, you know, he's really wired on the stage. So that's interesting.
Yeah, I agree.
Mm.
Okay, I thought it would be a good time to watch the 50-foot Queenie video together, because like we were talking about her developing this kind of intense stage persona that you can see in this video, and you can get a feel for the intensity of the band. So let's check it out.
Wow.
Yay, PJ.
Yeah.
I think her the character is kind of funny too. Like, I mean, just that she's holding that little gold purse the whole time, I think is think it's kind of funny. Like, I don't know. Like, and just the kind of ridiculous sunglasses. I don't know. I feel like there's a bit of comedy to her appearance somehow in that. It looks like a little kid playing dress up or something, like a little girl pretending to be a glamorous woman or something. But I feel like she's mocking something. Yeah.
Hmm. Yeah, yeah. Maybe she's trying to. I think her music sometimes related to the identity or something. Mm-hmm. So maybe she's trying to break some identity limitation or something. I don't know. Yeah. Yeah, she's trying to mark something.
So for you, is it important? So do you feel like this is a feminist album? Or like, is it important? Is this album important for you as a woman? Or
I saw a lot of reviews that, or a lot of people talking about her, she's a feminist or something, her music related to feminist. But when I looked into the lyrics, the content of the lyrics, I don't think so, actually. It's her lyrics or this Rid of Me, this album, actually related to some love or some things. I cannot see many feminist elements in this album, but her music was really powerful. So maybe that's something, it can represent some woman power. But the content of music itself, I don't think it related to be feminist or something. It's just my personal thinking. Yeah.
Well, yeah, and she says that she's not especially feminist.
I remember. Yeah, yeah, she said that.
And
not, she didn't do it on purpose or intentionally, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Just because her music was really powerful, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, she said she doesn't think of gender when she writes. I think is interesting. But I think because it's such powerful music, because I always felt a kind of deep connection with this album. And for me, like, not only, so this is one of the few albums from that time, like early 90s, that I still kind of regularly listen to now, right? Maybe, mm-hmm. I mean, maybe once every 3 months or so, not every day, but mm-hmm. I don't know, for me, it's one of my all-time favorite albums, right? So for me, it's not, my connection to the album has lasted longer than other music that I heard at that time, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought it was kind of mysterious, like, why do I feel such a connection with a female artist, right? Because if it's, and if it is feminist, like, why do I feel that so strongly, right? But I think it's what you're saying is that the music is so intense and emotional, right?
Yeah.
That whether she's singing about feminist issues or not, it still kind of makes a statement that a female artist could be that powerful, right?
Yeah. Yeah, that's a point, I think.
Yeah. So maybe that's what I connect to, too.
Like, yeah, it doesn't matter with the gender, actually. It's just, yeah.
So you had the book you wanted to show the, you read the book,
yeah,
a book about her?
It's The Hollow of the Hand. It's her first book, I think.
PJ Harvey.
Yeah, The Hollow of the Hand. Ah. It's her poetry.
Okay.
And it's like she went to the Kosovo or some places like that. So, and it's like the, how do I say that? She traveled a lot. I think she write this kind of book, this kind of poem when she made the album named Let England Shake.
Okay.
Hmm. And Marnie, a dog called Marnie, I think. It's just something related to this poetry,
okay,
or some social issues. So I just suddenly noticed that I have this book. That's all.
Have you read it? Is it good?
Yeah, I've read it. And when I read to her poetry, I always imagine that she's singing, you know, because her lyrics always, she always like read her lyrics, not saying it, right? Like whispering the lyrics, then scream. So, so her poem, it kind of, I have same feeling of her poem.
So you can hear her voice whispering to you?
Yeah, when I read this book, I always imagine I can, you know, her voice is just around my brain.
Mm-hmm. Good. That's a good situation, right? Wait, so you said your friend first introduced you to PJ Harvey. So was that, I remember last time I talked to you, you mentioned about a record store.
Yeah, that's him.
Okay.
So he's the owner of the record store, and he recommended this album to me. Yeah, CD actually.
Okay.
CD shop, not record shop.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, I first had it on CD in the 90s. Yeah. I only started buying records recently. So before that, I always bought CDs. So this was the first PJ Harvey album you heard, and then did you buy the rest of her albums from that record store, or?
Oh, there's only one CD. It's The Rid of Me. Okay. And I listened her another music on the internet.
Okay.
At that time, yeah. In China, you cannot buy many CDs and albums from foreign countries, actually.
Okay.
It's kind of illegal.
Okay.
But, yeah.
So have you been to record stores in Japan yet?
Yeah, of course, yeah. I've been to HMV and Tower Record and some independent record store in Shimokitazawa.
So you mentioned so let's look at the track listing. Wait just a moment. Oh, so you mentioned you wanted to talk about Snake. Is that right?
Yeah. I don't know. I think because the first time I listened to Snake, I was really shocked. I mean, it's like she's mad at someone, and she, so it's kind of, I think if we're talking about families, feminists or something, this song is kind of the represent of, maybe this song is the reason why people talking about her as a feminist, because like she, I don't know how to describe my feelings. It's just really shocked, you know. Yeah. And how do you feel about this song?
About Snake?
Let's
listen to it together. It's a short song, yeah. So let's I think we should play it. Just a moment. Okay, so we're going to listen to that track. It's Snake by PJ Harvey off Rid of Me. Let's check it out. So you were very shocked the first time you heard that?
Yeah, because I never heard a sound like say, mm-hmm. you know, she screamed, and she sounds desperate to me, mm-hmm. in sound, and it's really, and it's also experimental.
Yeah.
To me. It's like she I don't think she's saying the lyrics, right? She just read the lyrics, read it like read a poem.
Okay.
So, and with some really rough and intense it sounds really emotional to me.
Mm.
So yeah, I think it's just I was really shocked by this song. Even I mean the first time I listened to the Rid of Me, the song of Rid of Me, not the album.
Yeah.
Rid of Me, I was shocked. And then I listened to everything, and when it turns Snake, I was shocked again. Wow. It's like more and more powerful. I didn't expect
because that's pretty late in the album, right, to feel shocked. So
I was shocked again. So I just had this really, I was impressed by this song.
Sure.
I don't have the specific reason to why I chose this song. It's just I was really depressed. I was really impressed. Yeah.
Well, it is almost that song doesn't have a lot of structure, right? It's just kind of an explosion of emotion, right?
Yeah. But, the explosion of this emotion. Yeah.
So I never looked at the lyrics of that song until today. So
Nice.
it's actually it's about Adam and Eve and the snake, right? And the snake convincing the Eve to take the fruit. Do you know the story of Adam and Eve?
I don't know,
Okay.
actually.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, it's interesting. I just focus on the,
Yeah, no,
you
well,
know.
me too. I didn't know the Adam and Eve connection until today. Yeah, if that website Genius, I think it's Genius, where it explains lyrics to songs, and yeah, sometimes you can find interesting information there.
Got
And
it.
yeah, I think it's fun when, especially an album you've listened to many times, but you haven't exactly thought about the lyrics, right? So I think sometimes it's fun to go, oh, okay. Like Yuri G is about a Russian astronaut. Yeah. So
I don't know
yeah, well,
that.
I didn't know until today. Just when
Wow.
I was read I read that website.
Wow.
But I've always kind of felt that this is almost a concept album, right? Like for me, all of these songs kind of fit together in a very nice way. Like there's a oh, like some of the songs. Okay, like so man size, and then 50-foot queenie. So in both cases we're talking about like sexual identity and size, right? So it's almost like man size is an answer to 50-foot queenie and vice versa, right? There was another, I feel like there was another one I felt that had kind of relationship, but just in general. Oh, okay. Yeah, like rub till it bleeds and dry, I feel, are kind of the opposite of each other somehow, but both very intense. I don't know. I think there's a lot of very interesting imagery, lyrical imagery in this album. So when you listen to this, do you focus on the English? Like, do you try to understand? Well, of course you have the tattoo. So to some
But
degree you
now this
do.
album, I see. I think this album, I only focus on the frame, right? You
Okay.
know, the way she performed the song, and I focused on the instruments, her the way she you know, screaming or whispering, like the combination of the music, not the particularly not the lyrics.
Sure, that's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Only the read of me, I was trying to understand the lyrics the first time when I listened to it. I mean, what's the meaning of rid of me when I first you know, when I first listened to the rid of me, and I kind of trying to translate the lyrics, but only rid of me.
Okay. 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 Oh, so we had some technical difficulty there for a second, but all right, let's continue. Yeah, as we mentioned, she does a Bob Dylan cover on here, Highway 61 Revisited. Her parents were big Bob Dylan fans, and her parents suggested she cover this song. So I think that's interesting. Okay, so just yeah, in closing, I just wanted to mention the legacy of the album. So when Pitchfork did, right, their Sunday retro review of it 3 years ago. They gave it a perfect 10 out of 10. So, yeah, I think it deserves that. So as I've said, it's an album that, you know, blew my mind when I first heard it, you know, 28 years ago. And yeah. I still think it sounds amazing, right? So
I have the same feeling. It still, you know, has its power.
Do you agree, Kay? 10 out of 10?
Of course. It's one of my favorite albums. Turn is, yeah, this album was 10 score, 10 ranking. The best ranking, yeah. It's worth it.
And Rolling Stone magazine, you know, the American
I know.
Rock magazine. So they had their list of 500 greatest albums of all time. And this is number 153, right?
153.
Yeah, on the 500. Yeah. On a previous list Rolling Stone made, it was a similar list, right? 500 greatest albums. It was 406, right? But in the most recent list, it's gone up, right? All the way to 153. So kind of the reputation of this album is going up and up as time passes. So I think it's interesting.
Yeah, glad to hear that. Yeah, it's...
And yeah, so on that list, I haven't seen the whole list, but on the list, there are three PJ Harvey albums. So also To Bring You My Love and Stories from the City, Stories from the Sea, also on the list, right? So PJ has had a very successful career, right? So,
yeah. The title is from Stories album, Not Dry.
Not Dry, Stories, okay.
Yeah, I'm confused, sorry, just suddenly. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. I also love the Stories from the Cities.
Okay.
Yeah.
So maybe we can talk about that someday, right?
Yeah.
So she's the only person. So you know the Mercury Prize in the UK?
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I know.
So it's the prize for the best album from a UK artist, I think, for that year. And she's the only person to ever win it twice, right?
Yeah.
For 2001, Stories from the City, Stories from the Sea, and 2011, Let England Shake. So,
I see.
Yeah, two-time champion.
Yeah.
So, yeah, she's a badass, right?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. She's a great musician and artist, I think.
Okay, well, there you go. That was episode 28. And Kay, thanks for joining us. That was great, right? And again, your English was amazing throughout the whole episode. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear that.
And we'll definitely do it again. And yeah, hopefully hang out on campus once the pandemic has passed. Right.
Yeah.
Okay, so I thought we would go out with the title track, right? Rid of Me, the first song on the album. It's really one of my favorite opening tracks of any album ever. It's just so intense and powerful, and I love it. So
me too. I love it.
Okay.
Let's listen to this song.
Okay. All right. So thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for watching.
Don't leave.